almost don't want to have this conversation with everyone because everyone doesn't understand it. I'm in a space. I'm in a space. Look, even my tone is changing. I'm in a space where I'm okay. They don't understand, but I am an absolute monster. I could care less about you for 12 seconds.
Welcome back to another episode of The Burn. I am Ben Newman, and you know how we do this every single week. We're going to bring you a story of an athlete, an entertainer, a celebrity, somebody who has recognized that their performance, theirs at the highest possible level, is not necessarily because of why and purpose. It's actually deeper. There's an underlying burn, and it's this burn that ignites why and purpose and causes you to show up on the days you don't feel like it, and especially after you win. Today, we have a very, very special guest, and I'm actually bringing out a piece of attire. I have not worn this attire for one single Burn episode. This is my Elite sweatshirt, which this is our standard Elite Mastermind members get Elite gear from us. And I had to do this for Dawn Harper-Nelson because she is as elite as they come. And I am so grateful for the relationship she and I are now building through another previous guest, another great friend, Justin Gatlin. And then you've got Shantae Lowe, who's been on the show. And this world just gets so much smaller. But Dawn Harper-Nelson, you are so special, which we're going to talk about. Welcome to The Burn.
Thank you so much. Let's burn it up.
I love it. I love it. Well, here's where I want to start. So your story, which we're going to get into, and your passion to be your best one day at a time fueled one of the greatest track performances and track careers that we've seen. You were a gold medalist in the 100 meter hurdles in Beijing. You then fought in 2008, in 2012. And this is where you realized the strain on the body, especially in the hurdles. In 2012, you were the first ever American athlete to come back from winning gold to then medal again, a silver medal in the 2012 Olympics. So this is the elite of the elite. She is a Hall of Famer at the prestigious university, her alma mater, UCLA.
Yep.
And she won four Diamond League awards. One of those beautiful awards is right to her left. And her extraordinary career was fueled by her burn. I had to mention those things. I know typically we don't get into a lot of bio type stuff, but in an Olympic year, I had to highlight how amazing your career was. And I cannot wait for us to get through this episode for people to now hear what you're up to, inspiring others through your speaking and coaching and passions to really help people frame the mindset that it'll take to do things that you've done. So Dawn, there is your bio. Now we are rolling into The Burn.
Right. No, listen, I have heard your intros and I was like, so how much is it? Cause I need him to just follow me around to introduce me to the crowd. Ben. Like your intros are like, you're like, I am amazing. Wait a minute. So no, thank you so much for that intro. Seriously. Yes.
So I'd love to start. And I think this will take us into your burn. In your Hall of Fame acceptance speech at UCLA, you talked about it. And this makes me emotional because I always talk about my little eyes watching my mother. But you were so gracious in every gratitude and thankfulness. And it was so like your big award-winning smile as well. It was so present in that speech. But thanking everybody at UCLA, thanking your family. And now I think about, regardless of the track and your amazing success, how you carry yourself and that gratefulness and thankfulness. Your two beautiful daughters that you and your husband are now raising in your home, their little eyes are watching you. So tell us about that burn that came from your family and how much that burn now means in your home today.
So I was raised to understand I 100% have been blessed with the gift. Like I am very clear. I think so many of us have been blessed with a gift in different areas of your life. And to me, in a sense, that's not really the unique part. My mom was very clear, like, sweetie, you're clearly gifted in track. You're clearly gifted in these things. But what my burn came from is I am going to empty this tank every day. I need to know how far can this take me. I refuse. I don't do good with coulda, woulda, shouldas. I just don't. I never have. And I'm praying that I never will. Like, I just don't want to be complacent, especially when I understand I'm different in certain areas. And so, like I said, when I line up and I know that, yeah, okay, we all are gifted. Clearly, yes, you make it to the Olympics, you're gifted. What I'm really gifted is my discipline. I'm willing to do the little things. I'm going to do the small things. When my sophomore year in high school, there was a time when I playing around and I fell and tore my PCL and meniscus in my knee. And it wasn't really like an over-exaggerated play. It wasn't like, you were playing basketball, you know, no. Literally just playing with a friend, fell funny. And the doctor said, it's a chance you won't ever run as fast. Like with this type of injury, it was like a car crash. And I had never taken it for granted anyway. But this just really opened my eyes to what I've always heard, like Jackie Joanna Kersee from my coaches, on any given day, the gift can be taken from you. And I remember going running, you know, like throughout high school, and on this day, I will be different. On this day, I will be different. So for me, understanding that I had a gift and not wanting to take it for granted and doing the small things, that's, I think, where my burn comes from. I want to see how far this gift can take me.
How has challenge and adversity played a role in that burn?
In ways you don't want to. Like, no one wants to deal with the challenges and adversity. But I think we all have heard this before, but it showed me how much do I want it. 2008, when I won gold, actually February 29th, leap year, I had to have knee surgery. And I have been doing all the work. Like, listen, everyone, all the work. You know how coaches and parents just hope that they understand and they do the detail work. I was doing all of it. Because I laugh and I say, I had negative money. Like, I had no money. I was working 3 jobs, also training. So if you include that, that's 4 jobs, fighting for this dream of track and field. And something was wrong with my knee. I fly back home. This is California, fly back to St. Louis. I see Dr. Lehman. And he's like, yeah, you're going to have knee surgery. I remember being so angry with God because I was so confused. I have so much on my plate. Are you serious that you think I can handle one more thing? This is the one time you're wrong. Like, I was so angry. On my watch, I pushed 60 seconds. He stepped out. I lost it. I'm like, you got it. And I was like, all right, what do we have to do? What's up? What's next? I'm like, so what's the plan? Because I 60 seconds. Acknowledge how I felt. The challenge seems so insurmountable. Like, God's going to have to, like, he's going to have to come down and help me himself. There's no way I can... That's the 60 seconds after that. It's 100% possible. Straighten up. It's 100% possible. Like I said, there's no woulda, coulda, shouldas. Like, if it won't be, it won't be, because I refuse. And so that challenge is one that I'm very clear was my foundation has shattered. That's what it felt like. There was nothing. I was falling into the depths of the abyss. And I'm like, how do you get out? Well, if I have to create another foundation, then that's what I'll do. Like, I was so set on, I'm making this team and I'm getting on that podium. And I remember working my way back. It was not fun, but I would sneak on the UCLA's track. They would start to kind of lock the track up. And I wasn't running yet. I was still riding the bike. I would sneak onto the track and do workouts at nighttime, 7, 8 o'clock at night. And I remember it was finally time to come back to the track. And, you know, you have those moments where you're like, can I still do it? Because in my training group, there were 4 of us, 3, the Olympic defending champion, 2-time world champion, and the collegiate record holder, where I was in that race when she rolled out on me. And then there's me. Now understand, they only take 3 in the US. In my camp, 4th best. We didn't include Texas, Florida, no other place. Just in my camp, I'm 4th best. How do you believe in that situation? How do you, because you really sound crazy to say that I think I can win when the defending champion who has won the Olympics is here. She's rolling. 2-time world champion. How do you continue to believe? But I was very clear that I'm going to do the small things. I remember I had a moment where I had written down all these questions for my coach. And because I'm scared. I'm at this point, I'm like, I'm working, but I'm really like, but is it going to work? Like, you have that moment where you're like, but is it going to work? And I tell my coach, because he would do this thing of walk with me, talk with me. And you would walk around the track. And that was the hard conversations, right? And so I had written down the night before. I mean, I had like 25 questions just. And I go to him and I'm like, Bobby, can I? And I close the book and I was like, no, walk with me. And he's like, what? And I'm like, walk with me, talk with me. Because it was like, look, I don't have time for You got to put aside all this. The challenge is here. What is it going to be? And so I go, Bobby, do you think I can still make this team? That's the only question I have for you. And he's like, I wouldn't be coaching you if I didn't think so. And I was like, let's get to work. And it was just, you could almost play the Rocky music. Dun, 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 dun. Like every day was just like grind. I mean, I'm going home. I'm eating, drinking water. Was like with purpose. Like it was just everything. It was just, I had to face that challenge. Understand that this is a big one. The world is coming together to bring their three best. But I believe even with knee surgery, I am one of the best, if not the best.
Have you thought about writing a book, but just don't have the time? We would love to help you make that dream come true this year. Introducing BNC Publishing. We offer an in-house three-step process to help you bring your book to life. The whole process only takes 60 to 90 days. Compared to 18 months for traditional publishing methods, we work fast. To see if we are a good fit to work together on your project, email our team at info@bennewman.net. That's info@bennewman.net. Now, back to the show.
That foundation that you talk about, take us even deeper if you would. So Bob Kersey, yeah. You know, who was married to Jackie Joyner Kersey, was your trainer. Jackie Joyner Kersey, coming from East St. Louis, was the first to really paint a path that the success you had was possible. You're now the second. Mm-hmm. That's not a long list of individuals that have come from St. Louis. That's two to prove to individuals that there's a strong foundation that can be set if you believe it. Mm-hmm. How much of your foundation and to fight through that kind of adversity came from the insurmountable odds of growing up in East St. Louis?
All of it. Absolutely all of it. And I say all of it because I was so blessed to be surrounded. Like, I had people, you have doubters, everyone will, but the voices that were like, you are so loud, could you back up, were the positive. were the positive ones. Like my coach Fenoy, Nino Fenoy, who coached Jackie Joyner Kersey as well, he would, when you take pictures, when you greet in the morning, he'd be like, good morning, champion. You're like, good morning, coach. You know, like, good morning, coach. When we would take pictures, you know how you say cheese? He'd be like, say, I'm a state champion. I don't eat cheese. It's not say I'm state champion. And so even for our whole team, I'm talking about first day of practice. He's like, first day of practice, everyone, state champion. Because you're like, we're state champion, Coach Fenoy. You're just doing a lot. And what it felt like was he was pouring this into us and making us understand one day you will need this like the air you need to breathe. You will need to understand you are great because one day you will be somewhere like the Olympics where maybe no one else is telling you you're great. So you have to know this from today and every day of your life. You're going to be faced with friends that's going to say, hey, you want to skip school? And I'm too great for that. I'm a champion. I can't do that. So on this small scale, to go into UCLA and walk into a classroom of 300, and I'm like, it's about five African-American students. Okay, I'm still great. Going to UCLA's track and understanding Gail Devers, Jackie Joyner Kersey, Bobby Kersey has coached. He's gotten a gold medal in every Olympic since 1984. I am wanted to carry on that legacy. Can I? You're still great. Going to the Olympics, like I said, and you're lining up and you got Jamaica, you have Australia, Canada. I'm still great. So that to me. And then the love from my mother is, and I love it because I get to now be that person that can say, when the floor falls out, mama's got you. I had such a great example of that unconditional, and I mean unconditional love, because by no means as a kid was I perfect. By no means as a kid was my sister perfect, but I've never questioned if my mother loved me or if I was worthy to her. Like I would, my thing would be, I remember at NBC Olympics, after I win, I do an interview and they say, so what do you want to do to celebrate? And I said, I want to go home to my Aunt Flossie's and have Thanksgiving dinner with my family. And they were like, I'm like, that's it. Well, I have always been this champion to them. So I want to go where it all started, where I knew I was great.
You know, it brings so much emotion when you hear this type of passion and then you see, because that's what I love in my work is the opportunities to work with amazing individuals like you who have the passion, but then take it and go do with it. But you mentioned something that's so amazing is that you were told you were worthy in your house.
Yep.
And, you know, for the parents, which, you know, Dawn is a mother. Yeah. I'm a father. Yep. You know, we have to do a better job these days of our children in this fast-paced world of letting our kids know you're worthy. You are a champion. You do have it in you, because this world is moving so fast. We got kids who they don't even really communicate with their parents because their heads are in their phones.
Yes.
They just, everything is moving so fast. And what an amazing lesson to learn from your mom. It makes me very emotional, because I got that from my mother, but for a very short period of time, for 7 years, I didn't get that from my father.
Mm-hmm.
I got the opposite. I got the strain. I got the pain. I got the, let me show you how powerful I am. I'm going to hold back.
Uh-huh.
So for those parents listening, you get one or the other. There ain't much in between. You're either going to pour belief into your kids, or you're going to pour pain into your kids' hearts. And I really wanted to capture how beautiful that is, that mother was that source of worthiness for you, which had to have showed up when you would go to just the belief you would have in yourself from hearing those words in your home.
Oh, no, absolutely. I mean, like I said, walking into a space and being a Black woman and now being in a space of doing well, okay? Like, I'm going to walk into spaces, and I'm even getting on planes. You walk into business class or first class and you're like, only Black woman in here. Going into a meeting and you're like, only Black woman in here. I'm okay with wearing that on my shoulders because I saw my mom do it. I'm okay with understanding that. You'll have a conversation and they kind of come in like, hey. And I'm like, yes. I'm like, oh my God, now I'm worthy because I'm Olympic champion. I was worthy when I first walked in here, you know?
Mm.
And so, like I said, just knowing that, you know, from the beginning, and now with my daughter, my oldest. So I have two. Zoe, she's the little one. She's the boss baby. I'm going to be there just to say, I agree with you. That girl, she's walking out to the world like, I'm here. I'm like, okay, so she's just that one. I can tell she's boss baby. My oldest, she is such, it's one of those like beautiful souls. Like, she'll see someone that kind of like gets hurt. And she's like, mommy, they're hurt. We have to help. She's that kid. And I'm like, I want to keep that just innocence for as long as I can. And something else that I'm very clear, because you were talking about social media in their faces. Yes, she's on my phone. She looks at it. But I tell her all the time, I'm very okay with you getting bored. And people ask, like, what do you mean by that? She doesn't need to be entertained every 2 seconds of like, I need something here. I'm like, no, I need her to be okay in her own space with nothing else going on, and to say, you know what, I'm going to play with these rocks and draw on the concrete and create my own fun. I just need her to be okay with her from the age of 5 all the way up. So if you're in a classroom and someone doesn't want to play with you, I love to draw, so I'll draw right now. You know what I mean?
I love
just the little things.
What a powerful lesson. Once again, parents, I hope you're listening.
Yeah.
Now, I have to take you here. I've got to take you here. There is this beautiful, joyful, passionate side that comes with that big old smile and that champion of Dawn Harper-Nelson. But there is also that alter ego of Dawn Harper-Nelson. When you step up to that line, and you and I talked about it. I love talking to Jay Gadd about this. Tell us about the alter ego, where it's important to understand the power of your mind to flip that switch and to go to that deep, dark place where you know nobody can beat you.
You almost don't want to have this conversation with everyone because everyone doesn't understand it. I'm in a space. Look, even my tone is changing. I'm in a space where I'm okay. They don't understand, but I am an absolute monster. I could care less about you for 12 seconds. I feel so bad for you that you have to lie, because I'm sure that your dream will not survive right now. Mine is absolutely going to survive. I am so clear with that. From 2008 until 2016, there's 3 spots. Remember I told you? I took a spot every year. So that means only 2 spots are open. And that is my mentality. I, once again, they're like, oh my goodness, it's the hardest team to make. Yeah, for them. Like, you have to. First of all, I train way too hard. Bobby kills me every day. So you think that I'm gonna go out here and give you an inch, an ounce? Man, what up? Listen, you should have shown something else. The hurdles, I think the 100's wide open, but it's not over here. Like, I have to, in a sense, want to murder you for 12 seconds. And then I get done. I'm like, good job, girl. That was such a good race. But I'm really in this mood because I won. Like, if I didn't, I'm like, Dawn, you got to find a way to calm down and figure out what's going on. Because you have to. When that gun goes, it's not even when the gun goes off. It's actually before, in the warm-up area. Sometimes I was like, I don't even want music because I need to, I'm talking to Dawn up here. I don't want the music. I don't want to drown it out with, you know, ooh, what someone else is saying. What am I saying on this day? Mm. Like, what type of beast am I today? I don't like Kendrick Lamar, ooh, Drake, Diddy. No, they talking nonsense. I'm talking about today, the work that I put in. They don't know the work I put in. So I'm going to remind myself that day when I was on the ground, he was like, get up. And I'm like, you right? Because today I want to remember that. You flick the switch, you have to. And then I go back and I'm like, I love my kids. Oh.
But see, that's the beauty when you really look mm-hmm. at the highest performers. You know, Phil Heath talked about it, 7-time Mr. Olympia recently mm-hmm. on an episode. And you hear Justin talk mm-hmm. about it. And at our St. Louis Summit, Chris Pronger talk about mm-hmm. it. And, you know, Todd Herman, who's going to be with us in Puerto Rico, who helped Kobe develop Mamba mentality. And mm-hmm. I've recommended his book, The Alter Ego Effect. I have an alter ego that I tune into. We all have these things. Yep. And I think you brought up something interesting. People are almost scared to hear you talk about it because I think people live in fear of mm-hmm. actually doing the work physically as well as mentally to actually step into the person that they're capable of becoming. Was there ever a period of time where you feared stepping into that person? Or was it literally just this belief because of that worthiness where you said, no, I understand the difference and I'm going to step in right here?
I can honestly say, no, I've never really. It was such a, like, as a young kid, when I first started at the age of 12 was when I first started running. And I remember, like, I was a sprinter at first and I always got third. So the same, I'm talking about like Haley right now, just 5 races, really new to it. And those girls would just beat me. And I was so upset about it. I would go in the stands and be bawling in my mom's lap. She would go to the coaches and say, like, is this okay? Like, she's so devastated, but she's never run before. And they're like, hey, and they would tell, hey, let her keep that as long as she's not standing there all day and becoming depressed. But they're like, she comes out and she trains really hard at practice. So like they said, keep that fire. Don't put it out. Don't do the sweetie. Like, don't care so much. Don't. My mom was like, all right. So she just caressing my back like, I don't know what's going on. She's so upset. But I've always felt like I want it when that gun goes off. I want it to happen. I'm going to make it happen. I did an interview podcast about maybe a month ago now. And it was another track athlete. And she's talking to me and she was asking me kind of about, so your mentality, tell me about it. And I'm telling her, and she's like, her eyes got bigger and bigger. She's like, I can honestly say, like, that's a lot. Like, I've never, it's fine. She's okay. We talking about it. Cause I said it in the interview. She's like, that's a lot. I've never thought of, that's wild. And she goes, I mean, it could be why you do have the medals and I don't. And I was like, I'm just going to, maybe that's not everyone's way of stepping into that alter ego, but expressing that, I'm like, look, you have to remember all the sacrifice, like every bit of it. What are you here for? Why are you almost about to cramp if you're not going to take that out on the track? Right. So I'm talking to my young athletes today and I'm like, hey, I'm killing you right now. I need you to remember this moment when they're on the ground and they're literally like, coach, I'm like, you have one more. And I need you to remember this one more because we get to a meet, take it out on them. And then we get to the meet. There are key things that I say to them and they look over and they're like, and I'm like, exactly. Let's go.
I have to mention this because, you know, you and I have talked, and quite frankly, I almost became, and I'm just going to cut it straight for everybody. I almost became like angry and frustrated in our first conversation when we talked about speaking for you and coaching, because I'm like, wait a second. Like, I've seen Dawn online. I know this energy. I know this passion. I know this mindset. And I just want to speak to our listeners who are throwing events. They're bringing in individuals to coach and to speak on mindset. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of fluff out there in the world today. And I always share, this vein starts popping out the neck. I know I'm not for everybody either. But you either want me to come and deliver a message that's fluff, or do you want me to come and get real and talk about discipline and help people break through the mindset? Your intentional energy and passion to be a disruptor, which you're already speaking, you're already coaching, but people need to know that you have the passion and you should be doing that more. And people listening, we're going to make sure in the call notes that you will have no excuses on how do I get a hold of Dawn Harper-Nelson to bring this mindset and breaking down details and discipline into your organization for an event or to coach your leaders. Because Dawn, it frustrated me when it should just be a constant every day you're working with organizations, because your mindset applies to everything. Mm-hmm. Don't you agree? This isn't just track. It's everything. Yes,
exactly. And then I'm now in this phase where you were saying, what are you doing next? Where I am going and I'm speaking to businesses and I'm talking about the mindset. And it took me a little bit. Some of this is my fault. You know how you got to be that person that's like, okay, the standard is also accepting what you've done so that you can make those changes. I allowed others that put me in this box of you're a runner, you know, yes, you're Olympic gold medalist. That's so great. But you're a runner. That's what you do. I started to take on that persona. I was like, I mean, yeah, but I always had these moments where I'm like, man, I'm but no. And I'm now speaking to businesses and I'll get done and I'm like, nah, I'm gifted. Like I'm in a space again where I'm very clear that in connecting a message, I have so many people when I get done, they're like, I've never run a day in my life, but I see what you were saying. And I'm like, and that's what I want. That's what I need you to get. You will not hear me say, you know, because train like this. It's not what it's about. It's absolutely not. And I'm like, I need you to understand, take that piece that I said. And you're like, okay, I'm dope too. Right. And so that's really what I'm big on. It's like understanding that I have this gift to connect this message. And I'm now stepped into this world. So it's like, last time I stepped into the world of track and field, watch out. Here I am.
Well, NBC, everybody covering the Olympics, like everybody should be beating down your door to have the opportunity to be part of everything that's going to go on this year. And I'm just saying corporations need to take advantage of how special those messages are. Because when we get into these Olympic years, it is just special. And it carries. It's not just the Olympics. It's after the Olympics. It's the stories. And to really be able to break down what's going on in your business or an organization to reverse engineer, because you don't have to run track. You don't have to be a swimmer. You don't have to be a basketball player. These things apply. These are life lessons. It's so powerful. And I'd love to finish here. I mentioned it earlier to start, and I wanted to intentionally finish here. How important is it to you to be an example for those little girls in your house, those little eyes that are watching you every day? How much of your burn today is the example you set for those two little ones?
It is everything. There has not been a day. My daughter just started pre-K, and every day this school year, every day that I drop her off, we always race from the car to the front door. And when she gets done, she's always like, Mommy, I beat you. Like, I'm the best. I just need her to walk into the school, not even realizing that she's saying these things, that she's walking with her shoulders a little high. Like, I beat my mom. So if I can beat my mom, right? I mean, it's just the small things. Mm. It's those, like I said, subliminal messages that you kind of drop in there. And you're like, no. Go listen to your teacher and PP on the potty. That's just all I tell you. Listen to your teacher and PP on the potty. I am clear that I have a destiny now of helping them be the best version of Harper and Zoe they can be. My daughter has conversations where she'll say, I can't because my mom's a champion. Mm-hmm. By no means did I think in 2008 when I won, 2012 when I won silver, I knew I wanted to be a mom, but I didn't think that this would pour into them in the way that they know that they come from. And I'm going to just say it. They know they come from greatness. Point blank, you are greatness. I want them to know that. I need them to know. I am so happy that I have them in my life. It's almost as simple as that. Just knowing that life is being created every day, is growing every day. And I can have just an ounce of influence on that. Like I said, not telling them who to be, just influence on that. And I'm very clear that she's talented sports-wise. I see things, I'm like, oh my goodness, oh my. But I'm clear also in whatever your heart desires, mama wants to be there. People say, oh, I'm sure you're going to have her start track and field if she chooses. But I say all the time, if she's on the chess team, debate team, I'm coming with signs like, that's right, baby, we told them, whatever. I just need them to know that the foundation for mama, it is going to be there forever and ever until the end of time. I don't know. It's just a blessing.
Dawn, you are a blessing and a gift to this world. Your energy, and we're just in the beginning stages of our friendship and relationship. It's just a special energy. Amy and Kennedy, when they got to spend time with you at the St. Louis Summit felt it. And when I was coming up here to record today, Amy's like, you make sure I tell Dawn that I said hello. I mean, it was just, there's an energy about you. And you gave us a gift today that I hope people held on to. There's a lot of gifts in this episode. But the gift you gave us is the fact that you made a conscious choice to take the example that your mother set in your house, that you were worthy. And the story that you just shared, that you pour into Harper and Zoe, you've passed on that lesson of making sure they know that they are worthy. And, you know, some of us grow up in cycles where we got to choose to break it.
Yeah.
And some of us grow up in cycles where we have a choice to continue it. And I just hope everybody understands the beautiful package you delivered that message in, that we all have a choice, the blessings that we decide to carry on in our lives. This was such a special episode, Dawn. I look forward to the opportunity. And I'm just going to put it out there right now to let it be known. Yes, Dawn will be speaking at one of our events in 2025. You better believe it. Because like with that kind of energy and passion, that is going to happen. I just feel terrible. We already got our lineup for the year. I'm like, I need to create like a new event just for Dawn. But then I think the team would kill me. But
I know. They would be like, hey, we have it perfectly planned. Stop it.
But Dawn, thank you so much for coming on The Burn. You really are a special gift. And I can't wait to watch your story of helping people break down their lives, just create stories and champions around this world. So thank you for being you.
Thank you so much. And thank you for having me. But thank you for being you, right? Like I said, people are gifted. They don't always walk in that gift. You said you're on a mission to serve. Is it 1 billion?
Hey, and you're part of that journey now,
right,
too.
That's what I'm saying, right? It's just about like when you are this type of person, you just open up and people are just drawn to you. And I thank you for being you, walking in your purpose and making these connections. Thank you so much for changing lives.
Thank you so much, Dawn. And to everybody listening, please make sure you stay connected with Dawn. This is an energy and a passion that belongs in your home. This is an energy and a passion that belongs in your life. And her next chapters of her story are going to be so beautiful. And you better make sure that you're connected to her so that you can be a part of them. So we'll make sure in the show notes that it's very easy for you to stay connected with Dawn. I do have a favor to ask of everybody listening. Please share this episode. The lessons that Dawn learned in her home growing up and now that she has passed on to her children. Even I loved hearing Dawn say, I'll tell the kids, be bored, go play with the rocks and draw. Like these are life lessons that people need to hear. So I'm asking you, for those of you that have young children at home, friends with young children, friends who are going to be parents, I don't care if you got friends that have been parents for 20 years already, share this episode, because this is the type of energy and life lessons connected to a burn that are needed in the world today. So this is The Burn. This is why these passionate, energetic stories is why we do this every single week, so that you can realize the greatness that lies inside of you, the champion that lies inside of you. And it doesn't have to happen on a track. It could happen in a boardroom. It could happen in your home. But there's a champion inside of you that we want you to connect to on the deepest possible level to that burn, so that it ignites that why and purpose and causes you to show up on the days you don't feel like it, and especially after you win. This is The Burn, and we'll look forward to seeing you next week.